Hello, everyone, and welcome to the last day of the 2021 Summer FreeBSD Developer Summit. I hope you've all been having fun the last couple of days. I know the hallway track has been active. Folks have been chatting about different things, so I'll be checking in again with that today. We have several things on our schedule today, various talks, and I believe at least one working group session on Beehive. I think I'm helping to chair. And then we're going to have a closing session today. So stick around for that. In particular, we're going to play a collaborative game, quiz game, a trivia game on Kahoot, which will be a lot of fun. In fact, I think I have something to show you here. There we go. For the winner, we're going to actually ship off a special edition medal to whoever wins our quiz earlier today. So do hang around so you can see that. In particular, we're going to be using the app Kahoot that I know we've used, that Benedict has used at several EuroBSD cons in the past. So if you want to, you may want to go ahead and download the app to your phone or tablet if you want to use that to play the game. But we'll be doing that later in the day for the quiz session. We also have a survey that we would like folks to fill out just to tell us about, you know, how did the summit work for you? What worked, what didn't work? The link for that is on the wiki, and we'll be posting it onto the chat various places in a little bit. So please fill that out sometime today. Once you've kind of, maybe after the conference is over and you've kind of let it all soak in, do give us some feedback and let us know what worked well and what didn't. But with all that said, our first talk today is from Constantine, and it's about AMD 64 mode switching. So I'm going to turn it over to Constantine if you're ready.
Yes, I'm so.
Yep, I can see you and hear you.
Do you see my slides?
Yep, you're all good.
Okay. Okay, hello, I'm Konstantin Belousov. I'm source committer and FreeBSD Foundation technical staff member. I work on FreeBSD for relatively long time, not long, so long as other people, but quite enough to de facto see some interesting processes that happens in the industry and FreeBSD and related parts. So I will try to explain something curious that happens right now in the Intel area of Intel and AMD architecture. It is for external observers, it might be surprising that this thing occurs for such old and so to say established architecture. It is not as stunning as, for instance, release of ARM v9 architecture, but it's still a curious event. And I will try to explain why. Happens and how it affects operating systems, in particular FreeBSD. The thing that I will talk about is context switching. By context switch, in different situations, people might mean different things. For instance, most common is the discussion of the inter-thread context switching, where you stop executing one thread and start executing another thread. But this is not what I mean and want to talk in there. I want to talk about inter-protection domain context switching, when you program execute a syscall or causes a fault and execution changes from user mode to privileged kernel mode, or when kernel returns control to back to the user mode. Actually, on machines like modern ER32, ER3264, some more context switching occurs. For instance, SMI might interrupt any execution and machine switches into so-called system management mode or virtualization adds its own perks. But I will only talk about user kernel and kernel user mode switching for normal program execution of traditional operating system. Besides the words, if you have questions, you might try to ask them when I switch slides. It might be easier to expand some explanations while the topic is still hot. So when the switch from user to kernel happens, why it happens at all? First, there are synchronous events that are synchronous in the sense that they are initiated by the program itself. The program controls the moments when it wants to ask for some kernel services. Most typical situation is syscall. Another very common situation is exception, for instance, page fault exception. This happens hundreds, if not thousands, time on any system that is busy. But there are also asynchronous events. Again, exceptions could be asynchronous in the sense that it is caused by program, but it is not strictly controlled by program. So I don't want to use the word imprecise because it has specific meaning, but it means that by asynchronous exception, I mean that exception occurs in some point that is not directly controlled by the program, but caused by program. Another kind of asynchronous event is, of course, interrupts, and special kind of interrupts are non-maskable interrupts, typical NMI itself, or machine check exception, or unfortunately for the whole architecture, there is a whole class of non-maskable interrupts, which are very close to exceptions. It was discovered several years ago. It's something like, there is no established terminology. I call it delayed debug exceptions or something like that. So what happens, what handled when we enter the kernel? What should be handled by architecture to get the proper switch from user mode to kernel mode? Of course, we must save the registers. General purpose registers that all programs have to use on MD64. Else kernel need to establish the right value for the flux register. In particular, very important are direction and alignment check flux in the flux register. Another shared resource that need to be fully switched to kernel is a TLS-based hardware. I will talk in more details about it later. Another hardware resource that must be set up for kernel is stack. Again, in recent times, due to the meltdown, we have to switch page tables. So we need to establish a new value for CR3, which is the pointer to the root of the page tables on the for the current thread. There is more hardware in the CPU, but we don't have to handle it on the kernel entry. In particular, we don't save or switch floating point unit registers. We prefer to not allow uncontrolled use of floating point hardware in kernel and require kernel code that does it to establish special context where it will not cause corruption for the user mode values of these registers. And another well-known part of the x86 architecture is segment registers, and mostly we simply ignore them in the kernel. We are fine with whatever values were used by the user mode programs there. There are details, but mostly they are not important that we can get out without handling Sorry, my dog interrupting. Without much doing anything about these registers. So one of the big and large things that need to be handled on the context switch is TLS base. First thing that needs to be explained how TLS is set up for MD64 or x86 at all. It is still based on segmentation even in modern setups. But since MD64 basically removed any possible advanced use of segmentation that were possible in 16-bit or 32-bit, they have to do some after source and add the, in fact, ability to use at least some segment registers for segmentation in 64-bit mode still. Because there was simply no other non-too-intrusive way to get TLS base for MD64 programs. So how it is done? It is done with a segment register that is called GS, and AMD provides, Intel AMD provides a special MSR that allows to change the base of this register with full 64-bit write as needed. And because TLS is needed to locate any data required for execution in kernel mode, it was critical that switch from user mode JS base to kernel mode JS base can be executed without having any other context already set up. So AMD provides the swap JS instruction that exchange JS base with another MSR called KGS base. And what happens? We enter syscall with user JS base loaded into the register. We execute swap JS and value from KGS base which points for FreeBSD to the PCPU structure is loaded into the register. We get TLS, we get from the PCPU data, and we can fetch whatever else is needed to establish the full kernel context. But there are at least some important details that make all this complicated. First, obviously, if you execute swap.js one more time, then you switch back to the user mode JS base again. And this is fatal because executing with user controlled TLS base in kernel basically equivalent to arbitrary code execution. So we must not do swap.js more than needed. Second, after some time, it was realized that switching TLS base in this way where you need to write something into kernel control at MSR is actually very limited. It doesn't allow user mode to implement cheap threading context switches like green threads or tasklets or goroutines or whatever is the fashion that right now. Basically, to switch from this light thread to another light thread, you need to execute some syscall to reset the TLS base value. And it was very inconvenient. So Intel proposed extension to the x86 instructions where user get a direct control on the current value of the JS base without executing syscall. It is available on the all recent CPUs approximately 10 years or newer, say, starting with EV Bridge, I believe. So it adds a complication because actually kernel no longer knows what is the current value of the JS base when it enters the from user mode. This is one of the details that needs to be handled. It is important in the further discussion. There are, of course, other parts that need to be handled. For instance, we need to switch to the correct stack. we can calculate what is the right stack to use after we get PCPU data from switching TLS. But again, there are some complications. For instance, for syscalls in synchronous exceptions, when we enter from the user mode, we can safely use the switch to the top of the user mode stack. Kernel mode stack for user thread. There is no much questions what should be loaded into the register, except for PTI, but again, I will talk about this later. For asynchronous exceptions and non-maskable interrupts, it is more complicated because in principle, we can get exception, for instance, when we overflow stacks. So we need some mechanism that allows us to establish a known good stack regardless of the current state of the machine when exception occurred. And AMD64 provides a mechanism called IST that makes it possible to specify the top of stack for given kind of exceptions. But again, this also provides further complications. I will talk about this later. And you remember a problem that was called meltdown that was discovered several years ago and that is fixed by having separate page tables for user mode and kernel mode execution. So we need to, if PTI workaround is active, then we need to switch the page tables as well when we switch from user mode to kernel mode. Do it in the kernel handler for the mode switch. And last, I didn't mention it everything, but the third important class of the system state that must be accounted for when doing the switch is so-called invisible CPU state. For instance, NMI can be blocked on x86, but this state is not very visible to the kernel. Kernel cannot directly query CPU about state of the NMI disabled. It needs to understand in which context it is executing to make proper decisions. Similarly, there are some interrupt blocks, interrupt shadows, so-called, that have very limited scope. They are single instruction shadows, but they are still there. And for instance, debug exception disabled that can shadow the next instruction also need to be accounted for when we switch the state. Anybody have any questions for this block? No? Okay, so what problems all this have? It should be obvious now. Actually, it is very complicated. You need to handle a lot of transitions and understand how the transition from one switch to one, how the switch from one bit of state to another bit affects any other handling in the kernel. Why? Because switching is not atomic. It can be interrupted, for instance, by NMI or fouls that occur when you have some bugs in your code and that causes a nested, for instance, general protection fault while you're still executing the switch. And it would be nice to not die silently and typically cause a reboot of the machine, but at least provide some diagnostic to user so that he sees clearly what happens and can provide feedback so it can, the bug can be debugged and fixed instead of doing silent reboot. So each handler that can interrupt another handler must understand what exactly was interrupted, which state was already switched, which was not. For instance, if we didn't switch at stacks, then for PTI, we might overflow the very limited trampoline stack that we have mapped both in user space and kernel space page tables. So we might need to avoid doing something large on PTI stack and do switch to proper stack faster than we would do otherwise. if we have nested exceptions that use IST stack switch mechanism, then it is a fatal outright because second exception of the same kind corrupts IST stack. It would override the already written foul data on the stack. The best example is actually machine check exception. If you have non-fatal machine check exception, which is actually non-maskable, and second fatal MCE comes on and it overrides the existing non-fatal MCE, then we can't return back. And as I said, not all state is visible. We can have something that we can't fully restore because we simply cannot query it and should understand what was interrupted. If the MC handler interrupted an MI handler, then IRET would restore, reallow an MI. It should not be allowed, and so on, so on. So this becomes complicated. It was not initially that complex, but the complexity grown both when mitigations were applied, mitigations are naturally applied at the context switch time, and when some details of architecture were understood, which causes to handle more specific case at this switch moments. Similarly, when we return to user space, basically we need to rewind, but there are some additional steps that we as FreeBSD handle on the return. And for instance, we restore segment registers when we return to user space. And this might fault because user might create this context where register were specially written, which are not valid for user space to load. Similarly, when we switch stack and paging tables to the user mode, we get less and less of working kernel environment, and we have to work in and handle faults in restricted context. But we might fault when the last instruction that switches to user mode IRET is executed, it might fault for similar reason, because it also loads at segment registers. It loads user mode instruction pointer, which must be in the canonical format. If it is not canonical, we fault. We load stack pointer. Again, stack pointer for user space must be in correct format, otherwise we fault, and so on, so on. So fault handlers need to understand if we execute the segment load for user space, if we executed IRET for user space. In all these cases, we must do special handling to not kill the machine, but to restore the context, knowing that we executed in half the constructed kernel environment. So what would be nice to have from all this mess? First, it would be very nice to get the mode switch, context switch code more atomic. Currently, we almost have a RISC construction where we manually switch each bit of the kernel environment to get the final state. If hardware could handle more of it atomically, it would ease the work of fault handler because it cannot be started executing in the mode where half of the switching is done, half of is not. Again, it would be nice to get more elements of what is currently in modern operating system is considered a context to be added to this hardware facilities. For instance, TLS base, JS base. It would be very nice if we don't need to calculate how many swap JS instructions we already executed and avoid the need to, or avoid the wall class of the box where we executed swap JS one more time if hardware tracked it and hardware really knows in which mode we executing, so it can do it properly itself. It just was not designed with this in mind. Again, another thing is the interrupt shadowing. It would be nice if interrupt shadowing would not survive at the mode switch. it would fix both several ways for user space to maliciously affect kernel and simplify the kernel handling. It would be nice to get the explicit knowledge of the NMI blocking state. It would simplify something. And of course, the last wishful thinking is to not make it another mess, another level of hacks over existing architecture, so it would can survive several more tens of years without switching call servers to ARM or some other architecture. There is a question online. Are there any architectures that had atomic switching against NMI and false? I'm not sure what it means, atomic switching against NMI and false. Typically, all modern architectures really do not provide complex mode switching hardware. They tend to provide you with facilities from which you construct whatever you needed. So no, I don't think there are such architectures, but other architectures really define NMI more strictly. For instance, if you block it NMI, then probably, well, either you can't block NMI or you can block NMI so that it can, nothing can interrupt it. I'm really not sure about it. Maybe we should discuss this later after the talk. So problem, the talks about this problem actually happened for several years, and both Intel and AMD note that people are unhappy with this significant aspect of the architecture, and both Intel and AMD started to formulate some answer to it. And this is really interesting development in the history of x86, because it changes something very fundamental and very high impacting both the performance and security of the platform. So it started when some publicity about it started when AMD published some very preliminary and very unpolished paper. For instance, there were simply no bits or MSR numbers allocated for facilities that they described. And it was surprising why they did it in that rush. But apparently, Intel, following several days, Intel published their response. It is called flexible return and event delivery thread. I have no absolutely no insight why it is called this way, but it seems that Intel developed it at least for several years, because emulation of this facility is already available for Intel Simix. I don't have access to it, but I saw defined statements that it is there. And Fred is mostly a finished extension to the architecture. I would be not surprised if some nearby hardware would already provide the Fred facilities for us, and we can use it. So what is Fred? Fred is defines several things and change several things to make architecture more logical and easier to use for the operating system. So first, Fred defines an extended hardware context. It is everything that Fred can handle on the mode switching. What is it? It is the same thing CS3 possess RSP reflux as handled by existing mode switching, but it also adds the TLS base and something called stack level. Stack level is two bits, that is value from 0 to 3, it is considered as a replacement for IST. I will explain how it works somewhat later. And what thread provides, it changed event delivery and return from events. It guarantees atomic switching of the context that I listed above. It provides the stack levels and it removes the existing problem of IST where you can't use the same when you can't handle same faults that use IST because they override the each other frames. It provides, I don't know why, but it provides two entry points, one for user and one for kernel. It is currently when we have EDT, we have 256 entry points by type of interrupt and exception, but they are common for user and kernel. And thread, instead, you have only two entry points and they are separated for user and kernel. I'm not sure why they did this way, because you can infer both event and mode at which event was generated from the saved context and thread, but okay, it's how they defined it. So, there is some question. Question from Peter Grichan. Does thread permit stack switching for NMI and double faults? Yes. I will talk about it right now. Stack switching is very flexible in thread, and I will explain it in 5 minutes after I explain what is stack level and how it is configured and used for events. There are 4 stack levels. Stack level is part of the context, and for each stack level, you have the pointer to the top of the stack configured into hardware. There is a MSR that you write and which contains the stack base. Events from user mode start with the current stack level of -1, effectively. For each event, you can specify the stack level. For instance, for each exception, for each of 32 exceptions, you must specify which stack level, new stack level should be used. So you can specify your own stack level for NMI, for double faults, for whatever events you get. If CSL changes, current stack level changes, then the top of the new stack is used. Otherwise, if event is configured to not change the CSL, then hardware allows to use red zone on the stack, but effectively it just decrements current RSP by predefined value, then subtract the space needed to save the current context, align to 64 bytes, and write the current context. If how is defined whether the CSL changes or not? It is written in the event description bits that exist in the MSR, newly defined MSR. So what it does, it provides us with a way to nest the interrupt and event exception handlers without stamping on each other's stacks. It is not a mistake to handle lower event. For instance, if you defined NMI as having the stack level 4 and you have general protection fault occurring in the handler, then it is fine to handle this event. It will be handled with event level, with stack level 4. It will just reuse the existing stack for NMI. But I suspect that really NMR should be, I didn't so hard about how to really level all our current events, but I suspect that NMR should be set to level, for instance, one or two, and faults that we cannot delay handling, for instance, general protection faults or segment faults that can occur due to bugs should have the lowest level stack. But it is all that should be designed and fixed during the development. I didn't thought about it. So how the actual thread frame looks at the stack? Thread selects the new stack, then aligns it as needed, and then writes the current context on the stack. What consists of the thread frame? It actually consists of the 64 bytes. They probably decided to write the to write out the full cache lines out to the stack, and the new context consists of the almost exactly old 40 bytes, that is SS, RSP, RFLUX, CS, RIP, that are currently written to the stack, but also it has a predefined space that might contain, might not, but it's always written with error, with the vector that initiated the event, current value for CR2 or DR6 registers, that CR2 is the address of the current page fault. So they always write it out, and again, we don't stomp on the CR2 register if you have nested page faults, which is also very good. And they also added some additional stuff there. For instance, they write out current stack level in the space that was previously unused in the frame. And also they provide the state of the machine that was invisible with the previous event delivery. For instance, N there, bit 16, specifies where the NMI were blocked when event was delivered. So we have a direct visibility of NMI state at the event which caused the machine transition. Also, we have a visibility into the interrupt shadowing, and we have some classification of the event that caused the switch. We have vector, we have bit S that specifies that event happens at the enclave SGX security mode execution. We have event type, which is exactly the same as the VMX exit reason that is written out during the write-out. And we have interrupt shadows also written explicitly in the state. So we have a much more visibility into machine state. And of course, it is used during the return. We have two new return extraction. Old IRET simply doesn't work in the thread mode. We have return to supervisor, and we have to return to user. And both instructions take all context into consideration. So for instance, if you have NMI bit blocked in the saved context, then you return with NMI blocking into the returning context. So you can explicitly manage the NMI stack and NMI state, and similarly, you can manage the interrupt shadowing and whatever else is written there. So it all looks quite good. We have more atomicity, so we don't have to handle the teared apart context in the fault handlers for things like general protection fault or stack fault. And we have also other perks that are defined by architecture. For instance, there is no interrupt shadowing when we enter kernel mode, and so on. It is all written down in the thread specification, and actually it looks very promising. The only downside, of course, is that we would need to two instances of the entry code. We would need the interrupt handler, and we need to interrupt handler for all the database system, and we need the interrupt handler for new thread based system. AMD, in the paper, I will very shortly note what happened there. AMD just patched the architecture. They say we will not allow interrupt shadowing, we will handle JS base in CCenter, and we add the blocking for the IDT entry. Basically, they introduce a mode where instead of stomping on the stack, you would get a double fault from the already busy event. So it is a small addition to the existing architecture. And basically, if both AMD and Intel would go the route, then we would need to have three different interrupt and exception handlers, one for old architecture, one for thread, and one for AMD. I have a question, Manu. How painful will it be to handle both Intel thread and AMD SAE? Basically, it means that we need to, as I said just now, we would need to have three different interrupt handlers. So it will be three low level separated, three low level assembler parts that work in each mode. I put the exact references to the architecture papers and Intel AMD papers describing all this stuff. As a last note that I have, I didn't get hand with CMYK that would be able to emulate thread. And actually, I'm somewhat leery to start implementation of thread just with CMYK, because I already have a bad experience with five-level paging for Intel, which I implemented, and there is something in QEMU that is handled differently than in real hardware, and in real hardware it actually doesn't work, and I need to find the machine that I cannot find to debug it. So I'm somewhat don't want to start it too early. That's basically it. I over time, of course, but I think not too much.
No, that was a very good talk, Constantine. Thank you. There are a lot of interest on IRC. I think I saw at least three or four people say that they will need to rewind the talk and watch it a few more times so they can have it all sink in. I know there's a lot of subtleties in what you talked about. I was going through my head of like three or four security advisories we've published due to some of the things you've talked about with getting GS space wrong, or the one with Sysret and Intel and AMD doing things differently. So very interesting. And Fred is very interesting. So we'll see how this goes. So thank you a whole bunch for your talk. I don't think I see other questions. So let's go ahead and do our first break for the day for about 5 minutes. And then when we come back, we're going to talk about ARM64 on VMware. Thanks again, Constantine.